Humanity has been driven from Earth, but now it's time to take it back. Join the Reconquest and fight the Scourge on the Drop Zone Commander Hub at beastsofwar.com. In a world controlled by massive corporations, a steady aim and split-second decisions are needed for your Megacon to complete its goals. Begin your missions at the Mercs Hub on beastsofwar.com.
Hey everyone, welcome to the Weekender. I'm Lloyd, I'm joined by Warren and Justin.
Good morning everybody.
I think we're going to get stuck in and do some news because it was a great success last week doing the news. Oh, what?
Wait, we are going to do the news. What's been happening in gaming this week?
Right.
But before that, I want to show something off.
Okay.
Okay, I want to show something off and I want to bring out an idea. I've had a mad idea. I think it'd be great. Okay. Right. I got a bag from Battlefoam. All right, this is a brand new bag. Okay, yeah. It's one of the new ones. It's part of the PACK system that I absolutely love. So the PACK system, let me quickly describe it. The PACK system is a series of compatible bags from and foam from Battlefoam that you can switch in and out into bigger and smaller bags as you need it. Okay,
is this some of the stuff that has that kind of military-esque look to it?
I get into the Molle system in a second, right? But I got the PACK 352. That's this bad boy here, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, it's not the biggest of the PACK bags, okay?
Let's see if we can get that under the camera, so right there.
So, there we go. That's the PACK 352, okay? Do you want to know something interesting? That after years of working with PACK stuff, I've only just found out?
Okay.
PACK 352 stands for, the 352 stands for, this bag will hold 352 standard space marines.
Oh, that's what this numbering means. I feel like such a silly person. It never even occurred to me that that's what all the numbering was about.
Yeah, well, apparently Romeo and Co. had mentioned it some years back that this was their standard numbering. Yeah, and their standard code for bags was based on, so the 1750 will hold 1,750 space marines.
Okay.
And it has been tested, and you're more than welcome to try it out if you want to, but it'll hold 352.
Yeah.
Right. Let me quickly open it up. It's okay. Just this one I've got with just a standard loadout of foam. The foam is interesting, but it's not the foam that I want to show really, so I want to get kind of past the foam as quickly as possible. So, because you all know by now, but you're with the likes of Battlefoam, you can put whatever foam you want into these things. However, for the PACK system, that is the PACK, the standard PACK tray.
Yeah, let me help you out there.
So, if you've got two of them and put them together,
I assume they'd fit in a 720.
That'll fit in the 720 bag.
Yeah.
Or the 1750 bag, or whatever it's called. Okay. So, foam aside, because there's so much flexibility, you could be talking about foam options all day.
Yes.
The bag, they've assured me, is airplane safe. It was designed for airplanes.
Well, yeah.
Not that that really concerns me, but
if we set it up like that, it looks like it would drop perfectly into those measuring devices they have.
This is one of the things about foam.
That's the thing. If you're going on an airplane with this, are you going to put it in the hold where it might get knocked around, or are you going to want to carry it with you?
That's exactly what they're thinking is too. Battlefoam more and more are starting to concentrate on airplane-compatible bags.
Because that's what the test is. The test is to make sure your bag's not too big to take on to the hand luggage.
Yeah. So it's the entire remit of them going forward. I have also got a bit of news that relates to that as well. Yeah. I'll get it out of the way now. On this airplane thing, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Do you know the way Battlefoam do the hard cases? It's the black label stuff. Yeah.
Yes.
Is it black label or is it gold label?
I think it's black label.
It's black. Gold label's a whiskey, isn't it? Yeah, it's black label.
You can see where his head's at this week.
So they do the black label hard cases, right?
Yep.
They're now moving all the design and manufacturing of that in-house. And they're going to do a whole new range of hard cases that they're designing in-house and manufacturing in-house. And a big part of that will be, an emphasis on that, is making them kind of airplane compatible for anybody that's traveling. Unless, you know, when you think about it, for the likes of tournaments, and especially with the convention scenes and stuff now getting bigger and bigger, a lot more people are traveling further afield to play their games than they what they've done in the past. Not everybody's a big flying scaredy cat like me.
Mm. Although I do wonder how they're going to redesign it, because the Black Label stuff does have that really heavy-duty military-esque feel to it.
Yeah, and this will be the same. The other thing they're aiming for is a lower price point on it as well.
Oh, that'll
so
be good.
To try and make an even better value for money for those that buy into it.
Cool, cool stuff.
Right. Some stuff about the pack, okay? We talked before about they've introduced these kind of rivets and things like that. I don't know if you can see them. So they've introduced rivets, because I had noticed some stuff we had in the past started to tear a little bit.
Yeah, so just along here, that's where it used to have tears and stuff. This stops that from happening, does it? That's the idea?
And I think that's all very interesting. But for me, the most interesting part is this Molle system.
Yeah, this military-looking stuff.
Yes. So what it allows us to do is introduce this kind of stuff, little add-on packs.
Well, okay. Throw it under the close camera.
Now, this one here is for, I don't know, you could put your cards in there. I don't know if I'd put my wallet in it, to be honest.
Yeah. I think because you can get a good-sized tape measure into that.
And that goes on using these then.
Yeah, so what you do is you open them up.
Yeah.
Okay, you pick a spot on the bag. And then you just feed it through, okay? So it kind of feeds through like that. Mm. And the other one feeds through. Hard to see from here.
You want me to do it?
No, I've got it.
You're getting there?
Yeah. And then you clip it. And there you go. You can customize the expandability of the bag.
Mm. And that continues all down the sides.
Yeah.
It's on all sides, isn't it?
Yes. Mm.
Even on the front.
Yes. Stop getting some bloody QVC on me.
Jazz hands.
We're not giving away this bag. This bag's mine. The last time we had a cool Battlefoam bag, we gave it away, but this one is mine.
You've QVC'd me. I'll probably also get grief for turning it too fast. Too fast, Lloyd. Too fast.
Right. It comes with some other bits and pieces of add-ons, and this is where I'm trying to get through this to get to my idea, okay?
Yes.
So this one here, clearly this is designed for us to put our nice deodorants and things in, okay?
Or a can of beer.
It would fit.
You could get at least a can of beer or a can of Monster into that.
You could get two cans of Relentless, two cans of beer in that, no problem.
Yeah.
Okay? They have this one, which I think is very handy, okay? So, lots of little widgety bits and pieces in there.
See, this is where I would keep my mobile, my dice bag.
Would you keep your mobile in that? I don't know if I would ever.
My mobile could actually fit in that front pocket.
Yeah, but I'm always worried about somebody stealing it. To be honest, you know, it's I'm very reluctant.
You're rocking around on the iPhone 6.
So there's another little slot in there.
Yeah, that one actually comes with a little strap, if I remember right. It's on the inside.
And there, yes, it does. Because if you so wish, you could run around with this like some kind of man bag.
Nothing wrong with a man bag.
I'll let you turn that into a man bag while I show off the last one, which is becoming more and more important, somewhere to stick your tablet, right? Because we're all now buying into the whole digital book thing, so yeah, we're running around with our tablets. Tablets are becoming more and more.
But if you wouldn't put your phone in it, you're happy to put your tablet.
Yeah.
Well, you see, that one you would kind of notice if someone was trying to open that up on you.
So, and it all fits. Now, can I get to my point where...
There's your man bag.
There's my man bag. Okay, so look, what do you see? Okay, you see. You could have opened it up for the big dude. There we go.
I didn't think you were going to try and wear it on camera.
I'm going to wear it. There.
You look very fetching.
You look very touristy. You look very, very touristy.
Okay, as nice as this looks, what I'm about to describe will blow the ass off this.
Right.
Okay.
I'm nervous.
I have an idea for a product. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm leaving BC4. I'm going to start up a new company.
All right, Romeo, get your notepad here.
Called Wargamer Webbing. Okay.
Right.
Wargamer Webbing.
Wargamer Webbing. Okay.
Right.
So seeing all the PACK Molle stuff and stuff that Romeo and all brought out, I realized that what every wargamer needs is military webbing, okay? So I'm going to create completely customizable military webbing vests.
Right, have you done a doodle or something of this for us?
No. It's all going to be patent protected.
Well, like that stuff you wear for paintballing and stuff.
Exactly, but this will be specifically for wargamers. So there'll be plenty of venting at the sides, okay?
Right.
So is to let the air in and allow us to circulate. But imagine being at the gaming table
right.
and having a full-on utility vest. Okay? Everything you need in there, and you can customize it because it's all mullied up. Okay? And
right.
it's a proper utility vest. And that is where I would no longer be worried about leaving my phone. What? Why are you laughing at me?
Well, next you'll be telling us a utility belt with like a tape measure in it, and you just shimmy up to the desk and whip your tape measure.
Well,
and
if
then
I
whip
could
it
get,
back. And then...
If I could get a utility belt, right, with built-in laser beams, I just have a little button that I'm pressing and just okay, roaming it around. So
no. Just no.
So anyway.
It's just wrong. Oh, I can definitely.
Hang on, you brought up.
I can definitely shoot you from here. It's just
yeah.
wrong.
No.
So it's the name of the company has changed slightly. It's now WargamingWebbingAndUtilityBelts.com.
Right.
Okay? And what I want is I want proper full-on webbing that I can customize. So whereas I'd be reluctant to leave my phone or my wallet strapped maybe
right,
to a
Right, you're
going to
put it into a waterproof pouch underneath your sweaty armpit where you know no one's going near.
Exactly. I'm going to have it all there. I'm going to be kitted out. I'm going to have my dice. I'm going to have my templates. I'm going to have my iPad strapped to the back. You know, I can whip it out. Or even better, my rule book. So, as you know, in that key moment, I can just whip out and say, well,
there's
according
thing,
to the rule book.
I would suggest rule book, not iPad, because I've seen you sit on iPhones before.
I would also suggest there's a little thing I saw online. It's a metal case, but it folds out into a seat,
mm-hmm.
which you could just take it off, flip it out, sit down.
So I have a seat built into the vest.
Possibly.
Yes. There'll be a fold-down bit at the back with a set of legs
right.
that gives me a seat. Or, no, actually,
right.
you don't need a seat. What it'll be is a telescopic rod that,
right, that
rolls out.
That comes out down around the posterior area.
And you just lean on it. And you're at the gaming table, but you can lean
right.
on the telescopic rod.
Or if you're playing in a room with big windows, you could get massive suckers and just hook yourself onto the window.
That would be an optional extra. That wouldn't come packaged in it. But I would get suckers. So if you get that, don't really annoy an opponent. The little guy's really young, he's new to wargaming, and he already knows more than you. You say, hey, I've got Wargamer webbing and utilitybelts.com product for you to try. And you put it on him, you have the optional suckers at the back, and you lift him up, and you go, so they stay out of my way, kid.
Right. See, I'm just waiting for him to go for the inbuilt defense systems for normal people who actually see us walking around in this. You know, built-in tasers at the hips, just...
No, but what I could do is built-in micro fog machines, okay?
Why?
So, you know, what you have is you have your laser beam.
Right.
What makes laser beams look even more awesome? Fog. What would make gaming tables look even more awesome? Fog. So you'd have battery packs, you'd have a little chemicals coolant thing.
Oh, wow. Are you going to add a gauntlet
your
to this
fog
now?
System would probably need to be near the back of the belt,
yes.
because the front's all going to be full of lasers.
Yes, the only difficulty is...
Well, you see, if you turn this into maybe a gauntlet thing, so you can actually just put it where you want on the table?
No, you'd have it come out to your utility belt, so
okay.
you press the button.
So you would fog it, and then you would laser it?
Yes. The only difficulty I can
right,
see with
okay.
the fog... is that you would probably have some difficulty getting through airport security wearing a webbing vest full of electric wires and stuff like that. That's probably not going to go down well.
Yes.
But,
but definitely not.
There's my idea. I think it's going to make me a millionaire.
Are you done?
I'm going to make $1 million off this idea.
If anyone's seen Dragon's Den, I'm sorry, Warren, but I'm out.
Well, isn't it just as well I wasn't asking you to join my company? Would you join, though? You're more talented than him.
Ow!
No, but there we have it.
Got fired!
My Battlefoam bag inspired me to create Wargamer Webbing and UtilityBelts.com.
Okay, and on that bombshell, I think we'll move on to the news.
Well, you don't seem very excited about it.
Well,
I don't know.
It's interesting.
Okay, Justin, what have we got? Tell me what's going on in the world.
In the news this week, first up, we have something that piqued my interest.
Uh-huh.
We have
Wait,
there's got to be something stupid, isn't it?
No, it's not something stupid. Ugh. It's the Siberias Lion Riders from the guys at Shieldwolf. These things
right.
here.
What have we got, then?
It's a set of three cavalry.
I like our dreads.
Yeah, I really like their dreads. Hang on, I've got a bigger image of that.
Yeah.
These are really, really cool. I want to use these for my Kingdoms of Men army in Kings of War, because currently... Kingdoms of Men don't have a model range from Mantic.
Yeah.
And I think those would just be a really cool heavy cavalry unit.
They are. They are some sick looking models, actually.
Yeah, they're really. They're some really,
really sick looking models. I really like the face armor.
Yeah.
I've never seen a lion in face armor before.
Or with dreadlocks.
Or with dreadlocks.
I think that's really, really badass.
Lions with dreadlocks. That's class. Ronnie, Justin wants lions. Lions with dreadlocks.
No, we've got lions with dreadlocks. We've already got them.
Yeah, but Ronnie loves the ideas.
It'll be interesting to see where Shieldwolf are heading.
Yeah. That's out in November then?
Yeah, that's coming out this November.
Yeah.
So I will definitely, definitely be trying to get my hands on a set of these.
Yeah.
And this Kingdoms of Men thing then? If Mantic aren't doing the miniatures for you, have you got some other ranges?
Perry's.
Nope, Deus Vault.
Deus Vault, yes.
That's where I want to go.
Are you going full Templar then?
Yeah, I'm going to go for a full Templar army with Lion Cavalry.
That does sound kind of cool, actually.
Because the Kingdoms of Men are neutral, I can just fold those straight into my dwarf army.
Deus Vault is a really interesting range. You know, and they've got some big things planned for the latter half of this year, apparently.
Yeah.
Or the latter quarter of this year. We're now almost through it. So currently they have the Knights Templar.
Yep.
They have the Teutonic Knights.
Yep. They have all their foot soldiers.
And they have all that kind of men-at-arms type stuff.
Yeah.
And then they have Mongols, okay? And then we'll have to wait and see what's coming out. But
I think that could just make a really funky Kingdoms of Men army for Kings of War.
It's beautiful, beautiful sculpts too in the Deus Vault stuff.
I have to admit, I like the Deus Vault stuff as well. And you know the way I like, you know, knights
This was you and me discussing.
Maybe the range to tickle that fancy for me as well.
You see, this was you and me discussing. I know you want to go Basilea, so I don't want to take that away from you.
Yeah.
So I'm leaving that open for you, so I'll take Kingdoms of Men instead.
That's very kind of you, Justin, isn't it?
That is very kind. Well, we get one more
kindness.
Quick look at the...
Show me the lions with the dreads.
Cool.
Yes, yeah, very cool stuff. I'm going to keep a close eye on Shieldwolf, see what they come out with.
Yeah, okay. Right. The next one is a little something from our childhood.
Mm-hmm.
The guys over at Riverhorse have given us a sneak peek for Hoggle from Labyrinth.
I saw this.
This was a bolt out of the blue for me. I didn't even know they were even contemplating doing a Labyrinth board game.
Yes.
And I'm thinking it's about time because Labyrinth was one of my favorite movies as a kid.
Yeah, well, whenever we saw this, I looked at it and went, wait a minute, that little guy looks familiar.
Yep.
And then they actually had to turn to me and say, yeah, it was Labyrinth. And I was just like, I see.
I really, really like this. I'm really excited about this. I'm excited about the prospect of some of these old movies maybe making a little bit of a resurgence, actually. So
yeah, without here, being a horrible
some of my
Hollywood
favorites
remake.
That I haven't managed to find. I've been trying to find these on Blu-ray.
Yes.
Okay. When I say find them, I mean find them cheap on Blu-ray. So they may exist full price, but my top 10 list or my top 5 list. Okay. Labyrinth is on there.
Yep.
Dark Crystal.
Don't remember it.
You don't remember Dark Crystal?
No, before
they
my
put,
time.
The were they weird. Put- They put, there's Gelflings in.
Gelflings, that's them, yeah.
And they suck all the energy out of their face through their eyes.
Before my time, I'm afraid.
Oh, you're missing out.
Yeah.
The Willow. Willow's another.
I've never seen it.
You've never seen Willow?
Would you just get him off the show here?
You guys just need to kidnap me for a weekend, tie me up in front of a TV, and off you go.
Yeah, Willow would be another one that would be on there. The Never-Ending Story.
No. Maybe, I just, this didn't dig it. No, it just didn't work for me, Never-Ending Story. Yeah. Never-Ending Story, na-na-na-na-na. It's
was that,
stuck
was that
in
the
there.
One with the weird white dragon?
Yes. Okay,
so I've seen
fluffy
that one.
Fluffy white dog dragon
dog.
Thing.
It's not a dragon.
But
it's
it looks a bit like a dragon.
It's a giant dog.
Okay.
It looks nothing like a dragon. Firstly, it only has
four limbs. I was probably 5 whenever I saw this.
What, and dogs look like dragons when you were 5?
No, I'm with Justin. It looks like a long, sleeky, hairy, white dragon.
You're talking out your backside. I have a little girl who's 4 years old who could rhyme off the key traits of the difference between a dragon and a wyvern.
Here's your problem. You've taught her that at 4.
Yes.
When I was at 4, what I was taught was, this is food, you eat this, that's TV, you watch that.
Oh, okay, fair enough. All right. Anyway, I'm looking forward to seeing it. I wonder, will he have the smells bad, Stephanie?
It's there.
Rule. Yes, but I wonder, will they have a rule
what
in there for doing it? The bog of eternal stench. Smell bad, Stephanie.
I've seen it when I was little, but not recently. I'm going to have to go back and rewatch
it. My favorite
bit
is the goblins, though, right?
Mm-hmm.
Ben was doing off a little article during the week where we were talking about D&D characters and things like that.
Yeah.
And I was struggling to pick between Rock Troll and goblins. In the end, I went with Rock Trolls because it can be more consistent with Rock Trolls. You know what you're going to get.
You mean trolls?
Yeah, well, Rock
not
Trolls.
Not trolls.
Trolls.
Trolls. Troll!
Anyway, my point is, the goblins, I didn't go with the goblins because they range drastically between really cute...
You mean golems?
No.
No, goblins.
Oh, right, sorry, okay.
I didn't go with the goblins. The golems was a different thing.
Oh, right,
I couldn't really tell... I couldn't really pick between the two, but I went Rock Troll, right? Goblins. Mm. I contemplated it because I've been looking at this going, I really like goblins that are really cute.
Yes.
But then they veer off into really nasty looking, so there's no consistency there. Mm. But the goblins in this... are hilarious.
Yes.
And I can't wait to see some miniatures of them. All these little red and yellow armors of suits of armor and stuff they were running around.
Oh, yes, 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 yes.
They're absolutely brilliant.
The other terrifying moment, I've got something funny to tell you. The other terrifying moment for me in this was when Stephanie started to get loaded up with all her collections, all her dollies and everything and all on her back. That's the same movie, isn't it? Yeah. Where she has to carry all of her belongings with her at one point. And then she breaks free of it. And it's a, kind of that whole thing about hoarding. And as a kid, that terrified me because I loved toys. You know, and I felt like that would be me. I would have to stack everything onto my back. On the subject of your monsters, though, right?
Yeah.
You were debating between rock trolls and golems at a time. And
yes,
I was telling
was,
you about
yes.
the golems. There was a very, very terrifying post recently. Right. On the site where somebody faced a golem in a dungeon.
Right.
And the dungeon master had went to great lengths to try and create the most terrifying, scary golem that they could face. His intention was to create the dung golem, okay?
Right.
But through a mistype or something, unfortunately ended up facing the dung golem.
Oh! Oh, no. No.
And I have totally made that monster canon. So watch out for the dungeon series we're working on, because I think Justin is going to love the dung golem. He's going to be so
this
cool.
This was put out last week. Everybody else out there, you just lost.
Yeah.
He won that.
If you go into XLBS, join backstage, for goodness sake, if you're watching this, you're missing all the best bits. Come and join backstage.
If it's this good here.
Get into the XLBS versions of this show, because we're currently having a big debate about the kind of monsters that he should be facing down a dungeon. Dung Golem has just went top of the list. You know what?
I just see my character quivering in fear.
Oh, dear. I just see a lot of quivering, to be honest.
What was the name of the bad guy in this movie? What is his actual real name?
David Bowie.
That's it. There's horrible images of him doing this.
But was it David Bowie or Ziggy Stardust?
I don't know. The same guy.
Yeah. Anyway, right. Enough of that. What else have we
next
got?
Next in the lineup, Classcraft have brought out more of their pre-colored terrain.
Ooh.
Really nice.
The post-apocalyptic stuff.
Yes. Now this I really, really like. Everybody knows I love my post-apocalyptic stuff.
Yeah.
This is getting bought.
That is some really nice stuff, isn't it? We're having a look at Eden at the moment. I have some bits and pieces coming in.
I think Justin wants to bring up some more picks.
I have one more of the terrain set here.
You've got some like.
You've got your diner, you've got your trailer, you've got your barn, and it just looks really nice.
Yeah.
Is that it? Is that all
that's,
shots?
That's what I made for it. That's what I made for it.
It does look cool, that stuff, especially if you go back to the one with the table layout.
Yeah.
I could see me running around fighting off zombies and stuff in that like that table up there with the road and stuff.
I wonder how they did the road. I'm interested in the road.
It just looks like the Gale Force 9 sort of stuff.
I've got to say, all right, it, as nice as it is, I think the textures could have been a bit better. I'm not as excited by the textures on this as I was on the textures on the stuff that they did that was more geared towards Malifaux, for example.
The old rotted stuff, wasn't it?
Yeah. I think that the textures...
I don't know. I think the textures
could be better. It's hard to tell from a photograph.
I have an alternative for you, but I don't know when it's coming out. And battle systems are going down that
route. Oh, God, yeah. Battle systems are
doing the
Kickstarter.
I don't want any pictures of it because it just occurred to me now. But they're going to be doing a Kickstarter for like zombie-esque apocalypse type terrain, and it does look very good too.
We should reach out to them and see if we can get them on the show again. We got them on the show last time to show off what they were doing regarding the fantasy stuff.
Yeah.
And the fantasy stuff turned out to be utterly beautiful.
Yeah.
I saw one of the guys on the forum had posted a dungeon. Go and check it out. And it was like a 6x4 dungeon of all of this stuff. Now, I wouldn't lay it out the way I would have laid it out, but it was still beautiful. And remember, they did the exterior kind of castle stuff. But we have seen some pictures now of the stuff that's coming out of Battle Systems for that Kickstarter, for the post-apocalyptic Kickstarter. Mm-hmm. And it looks great.
I think it's going to be their best one yet.
Yeah, it is really, really good. It's so Duke Nukem.
Yeah.
I was looking at it, and all I could think of was...
Hail to the king, baby.
Well, I was thinking more like, what is it he used to say? Balls of steel.
balls of steel.
Balls of steel. So it's... So, whether he discovered these steel balls on this terrain, he may well.
Well, he probably didn't, because they're David Bowie who's spinning them.
Oh, yes!
why? Unnecessary.
Right, what else have we got?
Next up is something that you two are going to wet yourselves for.
I know what you're bringing up, I think. Is it the MicroArt stuff?
Yes, it's the MicroArt new Hab Tower and research station.
This looks good.
Look at it!
It's a hybrid between their hard foam and MDF terrain, Warren.
Oh!
Yeah.
It's glorious.
That's the two pieces put together.
Yeah.
Do we have an additional image?
We do, which is this.
All right, so do you see that lower bit down with the miniature?
Yeah.
That's basically the floors.
Yeah.
And then that other bit at the top becomes the base of the building, but you can feel them, obviously,
separately
to make different styles
and then
of buildings.
It's all stackable, so you can make it as high as you want, because I think that's two of them together there.
Yes, that is
to make the really nice high tower.
And the really cool thing about this is I think this is a mix between hard foam and HDF.
Yeah,
yeah.
I'd love to see it unpainted to see how it's actually structured.
Yeah, definitely.
Because I love the shape of this.
Want.
Mm-hmm.
Because
it's so not boxy looking.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, it's gribbly. It's cool. I want it.
I
want
to see how you would paint this up.
Okay.
To be honest with you,
right. Like. I know it's designed for Infinity.
Yeah.
Okay. But the Infinity players are already spoilt for choice.
Mm-hmm.
I have some other games in mind for this. Okay.
Right.
Imperial Assault.
Yep.
I would like
work.
To do some Star Wars in around this.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
I think Star Wars on that would look absolutely.
Yeah. Just multiple
awesome.
Towers all over the place.
Well, you could get the old Republic feel and stuff going with this sort of stuff.
I don't know if you painted that up nice, dark, and grimy, that'll fit right into Warzone.
Do you know what it would fit even better into? Nice, dark, and grimy.
Right.
Judge Dredd.
Sold.
Mega City One.
Sold.
I can see that.
Wouldn't that be awesome?
Let me bring it back up. For everybody.
I know that in the community we're talking a little bit about Judge Dredd at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's another spate of releases have come out of Warlord and stuff for it.
That would actually work really well, because then you can do the high towers and then the low down sort of bits in and around it all.
Yeah.
You really, really play with it.
Yeah, my hot tip is that stuff for Judge Dredd. Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely.
If there was a Halo miniatures range at 28mm, that would be your stuff too, because it looks kind of very similar to some of the stuff that's coming in Halo 5.
Mm-hmm.
It's good looking stuff.
Yeah. Okay, can I show off something?
I was going to... What's this?
This is what I want to show.
I see it on here and I'm like, what in the heck is this?
Yeah, right. I saw it as another news thing. I thought, has Lloyd put an extra one in?
No,
what is this?
Bring it up on the screen. Bring it up big, right?
Right.
Introducing Ristol's Extraordinary Market. Now, I know that we like all the sexy stuff, okay? But every now and again, something comes along and it's got cute pigs in it.
It's pigs, Warren.
Yeah, I love it. Bring it back up again.
And pig styes.
Ristol's Extraordinary Market. Right, what I really like about this is, you know the way I've been mad keen to try and recreate Fable?
Yes.
Okay? And I have the the stuff from Foreground.
Yeah, you have the
Morgenburg buildings.
Yep.
Well, I think this would be a perfect accompaniment to that. So if you're playing your role-playing games or doing anything like that, I think this is just, it's beautiful. I love the fact, bring it up big. Why are you looking at me? You should be looking at this. It's got hay bales in there. It's got a trough. You know, it's got lots of little barrels and stuff. I just think it's really, really cute. And there's one little piggy right there in the middle. And he's got the cutest smile. So he has just this one here. This little piggy here. And he is just grinning from
not knowing that one day he will be bacon.
Yes.
I think you're on to something, because the buildings in themselves, I don't know, used to have loads of them on the set, are amazing looking. But this will add that extra character and life to it. Because if you play Fable, the video game, for example, it's all the little details, like being able to kick a chicken,
champion,
things like
champion
that.
Champion chicken kicker here.
Really?
Yep.
That champion chicken kicker. Added all the quirkiness and loveliness to it.
Yep. Oh, on the subject of chicken, and on the subject of Justin's Dungeons, over on XLBS as well, somebody has also come up with Justin's almighty terrifying monster, the Chicken Lich, armed with celery and carrot.
Okay, goodbye, everybody. I'm out.
No, really, you want to come over and check that out. So.
Yeah. Right. I think that wraps up the news.
Yeah.
I do think we have some more new items we're going to talk about in the backstage show.
Yes.
So if you've enjoyed that, again, come on over to the backstage show.
Yeah, stick around, because we haven't even got to the Kickstarter part yet.
I think we're going to move on and talk about a board game. But before we do that, we're just going to tell you about some hubs on Beast of War.
It's time for 28mm World War II action. Will you recreate history or reshape it your way? On the Bolt Action Hub at beastsofwar.com. Anime cyberpunk style meets skirmish combat in Infinity. Experience 8 high-tech factions and fight to control the human sphere at the Infinity Hub on beastsofwar.com.
Welcome back, everyone. I mentioned we were going to look at a board game, Justin. I believe
this is one that's been passed to me to have a look at.
I believe it's called Dogs of War.
It is. It's Dogs of War, written by Paolo Mori.
What is this?
Ooh.
It looks interesting. Let's see the box.
So, Spaghetti Western Games.
Yep.
And?
Cool Mini or Not. Yeah, but it's written by Paolo Mori, who is a brilliant games writer. If you remember Libertalia, Warren.
Oh, I loved Libertalia.
Exactly. We did the Feast of Games way back on.
Yeah, Libertalia, beautiful game. Well, here, just before I open that up, I'm getting ahead of myself here. So,
getting very excited.
Box opened.
Yeah.
Nice piece of art. Okay, do you want to see
lovely.
The back? There. So, what is it, Justin? What type of game is it? I see...
The idea of this is, it's all set within a world. Now, if I get my show notes, I'll quickly read it here.
Yeah.
It's for 3 to 5 players, each taking command of one of the Dogs of War.
Yep.
So this game is about, basically, political intrigue. Mm-hmm. So you're not playing the houses who are trying to control this world, you're playing the mercenary captains behind them. You're the power behind the throne in this.
Right.
What sort of time period is it? Sort of medieval looking?
It's sort of steampunky, to be honest.
Yeah, it is. It's kind of steampunky. Can we get that? Is there a close cam we can...
Yes, a little closer to you.
Here's the...
Let me see if there's a closer shot that'll work.
There's the artwork, and you can see kind of knights, but I do see kind of steampunky type elements to that.
Yeah, so it's set in the world of Gravos, right?
Yeah.
And the whole idea is, if I actually grab our game board to start with, to lay it out, because that's the main part of it.
Yep.
The whole idea is, there are 4 turns, or years, as they're called within the game, right?
Right.
If I actually spin this round, lay it out on the table. In each of these sections, you're seeing the three battles that are raging across the world, right?
Okay, so battle one, battle two, battle three, and here's your years. Year one, two, three, and four.
Yeah. The whole idea is, 2 of the houses are always facing off against each other each year, right?
Yeah.
At the start of the game, you're given a card which tells you which house your Dog of War is supporting for the entire game.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, wherever your house is, you're going to have to fight.
Yeah.
And depending on who's fighting with you, because you can actually ally up with the other players.
Hold on, let me get... So
in here, you're going to have the houses. Now, there's a little set of cards here, if we grab them out, which actually show the houses and stuff. So, Warren, if you grab that quickly and open it up for me.
Okay.
Right, so...
So are these the houses then?
Yes.
Bastiani.
Yep.
Hackett.
Yep.
Harlow. Mallory.
Yep.
Talbot.
Yep.
And Tornbum. Or sorry, Tornborn.
You then also have these, which are the Order of Battle cards.
Yeah.
Right?
Let me just dwell on that giggle for a while. Off you go, Justin.
Okay, go ahead.
These are the Order of Battle cards. So these are telling you what you can win from each battle, whether it be victory points, new weapons, new soldiers and stuff.
Or a needle and thread.
Needle and thread.
Never worry, Justin. It's all right.
But basically, you may actually want to go into some of these instead of the actual one that your house is fighting for if you want to get a specific reward.
Yes.
Because these spread out across each of the battles.
Well, hang on a second, right? So let's spread this out as if it is. So where would these go?
So the houses go to the back.
And they just kind of go like that, yeah?
Yep.
Okay. And then what are these? These are your order of battle.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And what these are doing is telling you what you can win from the battle. So even though I might be wanting Talbot to win.
Is there supposed to be ones on there too?
Yes, there are.
Apologies. Okay.
Two and three.
Okay, yeah.
So even though I might be supporting Talbot for the entire game, there might be something in this battle that I would want over what's in there.
Yeah. So how would you...
So you actually play in your captain. So you see the miniatures and stuff there.
Okay, let's pass out the minis. So the minis are actually quite beautiful. Really nice.
Yeah, and you do get a lot of these in here because these are just the ones that are already out of the bags. But you get bag loads of them in the game.
Uh-huh.
But these are to represent your dogs of war.
Yeah.
And each of your dogs of war is the captain who's running the military, right?
Mm-hmm.
So each of them gets one of these lovely little cards, which actually shows all their special abilities and stuff.
Yeah.
And each of them has a different one. So if we flip this one, this is Nameless... Ooh, what is he? I'm actually going to lift him up out of shot.
Okay, so he's the Nameless Conqueror.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll pass you the other ones then.
Yeah. And down on the side here, you'll see his abilities. So this is you having a screen to actually hide your resources, so your soldiers and stuff, which you gather up through the game.
Yes, okay, so your resources and stuff, you fold them kind of like that.
Yeah, you'll fold it this way.
Okay.
Yep, so that the plain silver side sits next to you.
Yeah.
And then it tells you what each of your soldier types is adding and how much they're costing for the battles.
Yep.
The whole idea is, inside the battles, you're trying to put the tracker, which is this. You'll start here, and as you start feeding soldiers and stuff into here, and your captains, the track starts to go one way, right?
Yeah.
As your opponent starts to feed his in, starts to bring it back the other way.
Right. Okay.
So at the end of the actual turn, whichever side of this is on is who has won the battle.
Mm-hmm.
So it keeps it nice and clear and easy for you.
Yeah.
You know, the other things you get are these lovely little things. These are little victory counters.
Mm-hmm.
They actually have little bases in here.
They're like little... Oh, I thought they were bottles of booze.
No.
Look at these. Right? I thought these were wine bottles, but it goes the other way.
These are house standards. So they go together like this, and they go in here, your victory tracker.
Let's get one onto a closer camera.
There you go.
That's what they look like when they're put together.
Yep, and I prefer them like that. They look like wine bottles.
Bring the other yellow one over there, so we can see a selection of them, and then they go where exactly then, Josh?
If you go to the longer shot, you see up here along the top?
Yes.
This is your victory track. They'll go into here, and as you win and lose battles, you can go up and down the track.
Mm-hmm.
End of the game, whoever's at the top of the track is your overall winner.
So it goes from -1 to 7.
It's actually not that. It's whoever's at the top of the track gets that number of victory points to add to everything else.
Right.
And then you have a certain amount of victory points you get for the soldiers and captains and stuff you still have in your armory.
That sounds more like a Euro game, to be honest, where you have a number of kind of things that add to the overall victory condition.
Yeah, and then you have these, which I believe are your soldier cards.
Now, while you're getting them, so the miniatures, they're all kind of little busts.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and you get tons of them.
Yeah, you do get tons of them.
There's
another bag. There's another bag of green.
Yeah.
So, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, there's 5 different dogs of war, mercenary groups.
Yeah,
and then six
houses,
houses that they can be fighting for.
Yes.
And can they fight for any of the houses?
At the start of the turn, you can commit yourself to a battle. Once you're committed, and you can't fight against yourself in the same battle.
Yeah.
But it means that you actually get pairings.
Can you commit to more than one battle?
Yes, you can.
Yeah.
So you might actually have a setup where I've committed into this particular battle.
Yep.
But say Lloyd's playing this little fella.
Mm-hmm.
He could also commit into that battle as well.
Yep.
So you suddenly have it that you're all feeding into the same battle.
Can you commit more than one battle?
Yes.
So that's how you build up your...
Exactly. So you start feeding in more and more resources.
Yeah.
Then you also feed in your soldier cards. So if I move these quickly out of the way, you have things like your footmen and moving along. Zolfman. Ah, you have this. What is this? Aqua Buster, I believe it is.
Yeah.
Then we also have things.
And Aqua Buster. Yeah, it's actually called the Aqua Buster.
Oh, well.
Yeah. Aqua Buster will do.
Yeah. Aqua Buster! Right,
you then get your nice and stuff. But you see on each of them,
yeah.
You have a little number beside them.
So yes.
Your Aqua Buster's adding 3, your Knight's adding 5,
yeah.
Your Footman's adding 1.
Okay.
You're feeding these into here as well to try and drag that victory counter forward and back to see who's going to win.
Right.
And depending on who you've paired up with, you might get someone who's trying not to feed... Excuse me.
Yeah.
Who's trying not to feed too much into it.
Mm-hmm. Right, so let me get this straight in my mind. So I'm a dog of war.
Yes.
Okay.
Mercenary commander.
I've decided that I'm going to field my Aquabusters for the House of Tornbum. Okay.
Right.
And I'm pushing
Talbot. You mean?
I'm pushing forward and back.
Oh no, Tornborn.
Yeah, Tornbum. So I'm pushing forward and back.
Right. You're basically having
on behalf of the Tornbum.
Yes.
House.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. For that year or game turn.
Yeah. For a whole year.
Each turn represents a year in the world, and it runs for 4 years or 4 game turns.
Well, do you know what I think?
It's a very interesting little game. I think we need to actually sit down and play this.
I think we will I think we'll do a let's play on this one.
This is kind of creepy looking.
They are lovely.
Yeah.
Really nice, yeah.
I don't know if you can see it at home, but that's just really creepy looking.
Yeah.
But kind of cute, creepy.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, out of them, my favorite has to be this little guy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He's that little faceless sort of steampunky guy.
I like this one.
Warren had to take the one with the biggest hat. He didn't take the one with the biggest hat.
And these ones are ladies with hats.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Sorry, I thought Warren had took the one with the biggest hat and then nope.
So, Dogs of War.
It's a very good looking little game.
I really like it. I think the quality of the components is first class.
Yeah. Oh, the one thing I forgot to say, you do get a few sheets of tokens in here as well, if I can quickly show them off.
Yeah.
So, you get all your coinage.
Yeah.
Which is... easy. You get a lot of victory point counters.
Yeah.
House marker counters.
Uh-huh.
And the same again on the other side.
So, victory point counters.
Yep. House counters.
House markers.
Yeah.
Okay.
And a few other bits and bobs.
There we go.
It's a fun looking little game. I'm really looking forward to getting a go at playing this.
Right,
well,
let's schedule.
No, tomorrow is Sunday, so, you know, it's gaming day. Right,
actually, fair point.
Let's schedule a let's play as well, because I want to film my playthrough.
Well, let me get a couple of games under my belt first, just to make sure I don't get rules wrong.
Yeah. There you have it. Dogs of War from Cool Mini or not.
Very cool.
Right, moving on.
Yep.
I want to talk a bit about Games Workshop and their sort of move into... Well, not a move into video games. They've always been into video games, but recently they seem to have been hitting the video
There's
game
been a resurgence.
Market really hard. Now, it dipped off a bit when THQ and stuff went out of business.
Yeah.
Well, hang on now, right? Let's cast our minds back, right? We're talking about a company that was in that was producing video games back whenever we were playing the Spectrum.
Yes.
Okay? So, this was back when Games Workshop was run by Steve Jackson, Ian Livingstone, and it really was a games workshop. The whole premise of the company was that they were a workshop that created games.
Yeah.
And they created a spectacular game, one that we became utterly addicted to, called Chaos, which was a bunch of wizards that were, each were a wizard.
Right.
And you were casting spells at each other.
Okay.
Like gooey blobs, magic forests.
Right. How do you cast a magic forest at someone?
Well, because what you did was you cast the magic forest, and it was a defensive spell,
right?
And every turn, the forest grew a little bit.
Ah, okay.
And it might grow randomly, so it might grow quite a lot, and then not grow a bit. And then your other opponent, in order to be able to get a spell through to you, you had to destroy the magic forest in order to be able to get to it.
Ah, right.
Okay?
Okay, I understand.
You could cast magic fire, which was more attacking spell, which then left swathes of the board, because it was basically just a big square grid, unplayable,
because
you couldn't really get into it.
I see.
But then you could cast big beasts like centaurs and dragons.
Right.
However, you could cast them as real or cast them as an illusion. And this was the whole point of, everybody look away from the screen. You're not allowed to look at the screen. He's cast that as an illusion, has he? Because an illusionary spell was very easy to get rid of.
Whereas only
if you knew it was an illusion, and if it wasn't an illusion, then you just wasted your turn.
Yeah,
you know, trying to get.
I have to wonder how many times Lloyd kicked you out of the room going, no, I don't want you to see what I'm doing.
Yeah, it was a
cover
fabulous
your eyes
game.
Now.
So, you know, there's a great pedigree of, or at least a long pedigree of video gaming from Workshop.
Yes,
other stuff
yep.
they're most known for is obviously Dawn of War,
yep.
which was, for many people, their first real experience of
it's
the
It's actually what brought me
universe.
To wargaming.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was my first look into any wargaming world.
Well, Dawn of War was what brought me back to miniatures gaming. Mm. I'd gone to uni, I'd left it behind.
Yeah.
My flatmate got us in, or I think I got him. We were playing Command & Conquer and stuff, and I seen a new 40K based RTS, and I went, we are playing this.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it just sucked me right back in.
Yeah.
Because it first sucked me into the game, and then once the game, there was nothing left to do. Mm. You finished basically everything. You could keep playing it.
Mm. Yeah.
I started verging back into the miniatures market then.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
But
Yeah, well, I remember one of the best parts of Dawn of War was your assault marines. And what you would have is that you would be keeping your opponent focused on this part of the map because you could never see the whole map all at once.
Yeah, you had the nice fog of war.
You had to move around. But meanwhile, back on his base, you had assault marines jumping in and out of his base and doing damage. And it was very, very cool.
That was a distraction technique because he'd send an army out and you'd jump them in. He'd send his army back and you'd jump back out. And he's like, really frustrated with this.
No, you see, the ones that used to really frustrate me was the Eldar. Because they could do that whole invisible base thing.
Mm-hmm.
That was really annoying whenever you had crushed his entire base.
Oh, and
he just had
a
couple of webways about the board that you had to get rid of them.
But the difference is now with the event of mobile gaming and stuff.
Yeah.
So we have with consoles, with PC gaming.
Well,
with
on console you had Space Marine, which was a great game. Now, what I particularly rated, to be honest, I didn't think it was the most...
I enjoyed it just as a fun sit-down hack and slash for an hour.
I'm going to play it again next month because Xbox One's getting this backwards compatibility.
Nice. Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to get the 360 version for cheap and play it again.
Nice.
It's probably worth picking up. The only thing is that when it went into that element, it already had competition from the likes of Halo and Gears of War, which, to be fair, are much, much better games than it was.
It really was targeted at its own fan base.
But there's a whole deal.
There's now less of a focus on that AAA standard of the Dawn of War and Space Marine. And as you rightly say, it's now seems to be a lot more focus on the likes of mobile games.
Well, let me just quickly rattle some off with new screenshots, okay?
Yeah.
We've got Battlefleet Gothic Armada coming up.
Looks brilliant.
We've got Blood Bowl 2 coming up.
Yeah.
Getting that.
Total Warhammer.
Can't wait.
That is looking
Warhammer
very good.
Warhammer 40 Quest Inquisitor Marta.
Yep.
Warhammer 40,000 Freeblade.
Mm. Yeah.
Space Hulk Deathwing.
Yeah.
And probably a load more.
Yeah.
What I meant by they're very aggressively in the market for video games in so much as there's an awful lot of them coming at us all at once.
I think what they're doing is that the licensing department basically within Workshop is probably cotton on to the fact that if you only license your game to one developer once per year, the chances of you finding a breakaway hit are fairly low. So, and we've seen that breakaway hits can come from absolutely nowhere. You look at the likes of Angry Birds and stuff like that there. You don't need big EA-style development houses these days to find a breakaway hit in the mobile in the world of mobile.
Yeah, but I don't think some of these games Lloyd has mentioned are not mobile games.
No, but when I say mobile, I mean it fairly loosely. I mean indie developers.
Warhammer 40K Inquisitor Martyr is pretty much a tablet-based game.
Okay.
And Warhammer 40,000 Freeblade was used to show off the new iPhone.
Yeah.
Right.
It was the first game they showed on the iPhone, and that's quite
cool.
A lot of kudos for Games Workshop for the first game to be showed on the new iPhone is a 40K based game.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
So, I mean, they're getting a lot of traction. Let's talk about one of the upcoming games, for example. We've got Battlefleet Gothic. There's a gameplay trailer come out.
Yeah.
Everyone's seen the screenshots and went, oh my goodness, that looks amazing.
Yeah, I've gathered one or two.
Have we got any pictures of it? Yeah.
Well, here's one of the Imperial ships.
But now we actually have alpha footage of gameplay. We're just going to do some screenshots. So if I bring
I'm just going to quickly cycle through these. So here's what you're seeing in the actual game. And it does look quite cool. So you've got your torpedo salvos, got all the ships that you love.
Oh, here, that is very nice, isn't it?
Yeah, and then you've got all your miniature abilities and stuff. You can even ram people. Which I really, really love the idea of in this game.
There you can see someone's getting rammed in that shot there.
Exactly. And then you've got four race represented, so Imperium, Orcs, Chaos and Eldar. Mm-hmm. And then the four Chaos Gods are recognized. So I believe that's Slaanesh.
Yeah.
You've got Nurgle, who just, I love this one. I really like the look of the Nurgle one.
Yeah.
And I think this is either Zinch or Khorne, I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
But they are really, really nice looking.
It's quite Khorne-esque looking to me, isn't it?
Yeah.
So go back to the Slaanesh one.
This one, I believe Slaanesh is this one. It's all bright purple and gold
and
stuff.
You think this is the Slaanesh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, it's... Or is it? I'm not sure, because I think that might actually be the Zinch one.
I don't see a dongle limb on it anyway.
it's all chaos to me. I'm looking forward to seeing what the orcs represent or field and what the elder.
Yeah. The orcs are obviously going to have their big rocks and stuff.
For anyone into video gaming, one of the interesting things is this: the first RTS based on Unreal 4.
Mm-hmm.
ships in this are represented from a few hundred meters up to 8 kilometers.
Yeah.
Because the chaos have like a planet killer.
Yeah.
They'll basically decimate planets. There's a single-player campaign. It's not just multiplayer. Mm. Now that's what I look forward to in a 40K game, because that's generally where I get my narrative. I tend to tabletop battles, but get my narrative when I jump into video games because I'm just a bit of a lazy reader.
You see, my question is it going to be a single-player campaign where it's following one race, or are you going to be able to follow all four? Because that's what I always prefer in those games.
Where you're jumping from one race to another.
No, where you have the option of starting the entire single-player campaign from one or the other.
A lot of work.
It's what they did with Dawn of War 2, and that's what I liked.
Did they? I don't remember that in Dawn of War 2.
Retribution.
I know Dawn of War, you basically followed one campaign, and then they introduced new campaigns so that you could do it from other factions and stuff.
Yeah, but, that's what they did with Dawn of War 2.
I'm looking forward to giving it a whirl, because Battlefleet Gothic is something I never really got into, miniatures-wise.
It's something I missed out on as well.
And I'm looking at this, and if you watch the gameplay stuff, it actually looks kind of exciting. Mm. You've mentioned crashing into ships.
Yeah.
You can hide.
Which, come on, though. That is totally unrealistic.
If you're going to die, take the other ship with you.
Well, how is it?
Yeah.
Right.
I'm about to die. All engines ahead. Ramming speed.
Yes. Right. Firstly, we are in the 41st century, okay?
Millennium.
41st millennium then. That's even worse, right?
Millennium.
Even in modern naval battles, they don't ram. There's no ramming goes on. And the reason there's no ramming is because you have an entire ocean to move out of the way. You know, it's even worse in space. You the engines in these things, if somebody goes, I'm going to ram you, you'll go, no, you're not. I'm going to move out of the way.
But this is the video game.
The only way they would ram it is if it was already disabled. And if the ship was already disabled, why would you ram it?
Right, here's the answer for you.
I've been hurt a lot. I've lost most of my weapon systems. We've damaged their engines, so they can't move.
They have their weapon engines. Let's just ram them.
And why?
If the opponent has his weapon
systems... Because you're going to lose your ship anyway. It's not real world. It doesn't matter if you lose a ship because you're not really on it.
Yeah, but if you've disabled the engines on the enemy, your weapons are disabled, you have your engines, but they don't, then you'll ram them because your last weapon is your ship. Ram in.
I like it. I don't know.
I love it.
I know you guys like it. I am much, much more excited by the prospect of the Halo miniatures game and Drop Fleet Commander coming out than I am by this. You know, it's this is one of the issues that I have with all of this licensing stuff, right? Yes, I'm a big proponent of them opening it up because they might get a breakaway hit, right? Uh-huh. But I don't really feel like we're seeing anything particularly groundbreaking. I don't really feel like we're seeing anything that is really going to make me stop and go, I really like the look of it.
Yeah, but
it didn't take very long after seeing it for me to feel, I have kind of seen it before.
Let's put it this way. Say I wasn't a war gamer. Say I'm a video gamer.
Yeah.
I see this.
Yeah.
I see things like Blood Bowl, and I start playing it and then go...
Do you know what? You're absolutely right. The perfect way to recruit people into... an industry where we don't have Battlefleet Gothic or Blood Bowl is to get them really good video game versions of it.
That is the weird thing. Let's move on to Blood Bowl, right? So that's still in the works.
Yeah.
But Blood Bowl 2 is coming out in about a week and a half.
Yeah. And yes. They've redone the graphics and all.
Now, the thing about Blood Bowl is it pretty much is the tabletop game.
Yeah.
on PC, Xbox One, PS4. Yeah,
it's as close as you're going to get, right down to like dice rolls and
have
stuff.
Have we got more shots?
Yeah, we do. I mean, like, they've re-engineered it so the dice rolls are above your head now. You know, they've done some beautiful cinematics for whenever you're actually taking hits and stuff. This again has a single-player campaign where you're taking over the Reichland Reavers and actually building up and doing the stats for your team. You've got some beautiful stuff of the actual table. And you remember the guys who were in it, the commentators?
Yeah.
I think of an image of them. We've got a beautiful one of them where they actually have event cards in it now. So events where Bob joins the team, where the commentator has got bored and decided, you know what, I'm getting stuck in.
Okay.
And rocks out onto the pitch.
Yeah.
To pile it on.
But it's looking good too. Is that all the images?
Yeah, that's what I've got.
But it's very much the tabletop game. There may be some tweaks here or there.
It's a very pure transfer. I mean, there are some of the housekeeping bits you don't see anymore.
But it is weird the way Games Workshop seem to release games based on stuff they don't want to be keeping up to date.
It's the publishing house that they've actually sold the rights off to that's doing it.
Utterly pointless.
I don't know.
Utterly
I like it.
Utterly
You think
pointless.
It's utterly pointless for them to release these games?
I only care about this industry.
Yes,
right?
But Games Workshop may not only care about this industry. Maybe they're looking at video game industry.
And how
thinking,
would that, if Games Workshop were truly interested in the video game market, they wouldn't be creating a sports game based on that. They would be trying to create a better version of the NFL or something like that that would appeal to millions and millions of people. So either they care about their IP, in which case that's a pointless exercise, or they care about creating video games and they want to become a video game house, in which case their IP is probably not the best thing to be creating video games on if you
want
to create
them. What if
they
care about their fan base and the nostalgia hit that everybody gets from
that? We already know that that's not the motivation that drives
them. It's not the fan base, right? I contemplate maybe video games.
Just wait till I respond to that. Do you think that a company that has already shelved games that has a pre-existing fan base would then go out of their way to try and have it recreated as a video game to try and appease their fan base?
That's fair enough. But the other question is it Games Workshop saying to the publishing house, right here, take that license? Or is it the publishing house coming to them and going, we wouldn't mind having this license?
The publishing houses are approaching Games Workshop. There's definitely an element of that.
Yeah, and Games Workshop aren't going to turn them away. They're looking at it now and thinking there's big money to be made. Even in the development of the games costs a lot. Witcher 3, $81 million US.
Yep. It's a cop-out. The whole thing is a
cop-out. Star Wars The Old Republic, $200 million.
Oh, yeah, that's not going to make $200 million. But
I don't care what Warren has to say. I'm looking forward to this.
Well,
they're not going to ignore the video
what
game
this
market.
What this is a classic case of, we have a bunch of IPs that are sitting doing nothing. We'll cast the dice and see what happens with them. All right? I don't see any overall strategy to it. I just see them realizing that doing one per year isn't going to get them anywhere. If they're going to have any chance of having a breakaway hit, they have to open it up. However, what I would really like to see is them maybe committing to the format and seeing actually what is possible within the video gaming sphere. You even look at Total War, right?
Mm-hmm.
I am utterly confused as to the strategy of Total War. Here you have a game made by one of our most talented video game developers,
yeah,
right? So this is the new Dwarven
trailer
yeah, that was out.
Yeah.
And it looks fabulous. You know, as real-time battles go, this game is looking absolutely brilliant, right?
Yeah.
So one of the UK's premier
Yes.
development houses, the guys behind Alien Resurrection, no less, right, have invested their time and money into a piece of IP that Workshop just blew out their backsides.
That's what I
said. No, really, but how would you?
But that's what I said.
Feel?
I said it's weird the way they seem to move on to video games when they've been kind of abandoned, right? Let me finish. So there's Warhammer.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There is Blood Bowl.
Yeah. Yep.
There's Space Hulk.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's not really their thing.
No, it's not.
So it's weird the way they always make video
Warhammer
games about
Quest.
Stuff.
Warhammer Quest became an app as well.
Yep.
A mobile game. This one, to me, this one of all of them, it has the alarm bells ringing in my head.
But look how beautiful it is.
No, it's not about the quality of the game. I think the game's beautiful. It's about the lack of strategy. Or what is the strategy? Why would you have one of the premier game developers sit and spend, because years of development have went into this, and then at the point where it's about to be released, you go, we've done the end times, we're ditching all that.
No, but that's one of the problems, because you look at video games and think, maybe it'll bring players in, but I'm looking at it and going, I think it'll extract players out of the hobby. You'll have disgruntled fantasy players maybe just go off and play Total Warhammer.
That's a possibility.
It's actually three biggest culprits of that were World of Warcraft did have that effect for a while. However, that's now tapered off. This stuff, all this gaming stuff, is now becoming cool. Did you know that we are now entering in where we're going to be the hipsters? We need to all start growing hipster beards and stuff like that now.
No, but, I like my beard as it is.
You know, we're going to get hipster beards. Yeah. But it is becoming cool, this, right?
We're the new geek shape.
So they will go out and they will go in. The other culprit for it, World of Tanks and War Thunder would be another one that would pull people out.
That is fair enough, because I have recently started replaying World of Tanks again, and it is eating into my hobby time, so I do notice that.
The only thing is, from my perspective, and I'm right, it's just not as rewarding as the actual physical hobby of the model making and collecting.
I don't know. You see, there's a certain amount of it where it's the easy out for a gamer to actually sit down and play that. Then have to sit down and build and paint and then find an opponent.
Well,
finding an opponent on that is going to be dead easy because they have their matchmaker online.
Yeah.
You're never worried about getting the game on.
It's great. I'm utterly confounded by strategically where does it take them, or what is the point? Mm. This game in particular, because it is a beautiful looking game, beautifully executed by a great company.
Total Warhammer we're talking about, just to make sure you know.
And to see the situation that's in, I don't know if it'll do the game any harm, maybe it won't, but I just don't get it. I can't get my head around it at all. It's like, you know, why did they not work with these guys and call it Age of Sigmar?
But that's what I'm saying, it seems to be a mentality in there. Are we doing Battlefleet Gothic much? No. Make a video game.
Well, this is what I'm saying.
Are we doing this?
Take all the old stuff that nobody wants
and make a video game.
Turf it all out and see what sticks. It doesn't feel particularly strategic. It doesn't feel like a Games Workshop. This is why they're rebranding to Warhammer.
Yes.
Because they're not a Games Workshop. And that's fine. That's fine.
Fair enough.
But it feels strange to me.
Right. I'm going to move us on. That's video games explored. And
are we going to tell about some hubs?
Yeah, yes, we're going to talk about some hubs, and then we're going to be back to talk about some Kickstarters.
Humanity has been driven from Earth, but now it's time to take it back. Join the Reconquest and fight the Scourge on the Drop Zone Commander Hub at beastofwar.com. From Viking halls to the cities of the future, terrain buffs will love our foreground hub. Watch gaming tables of all genres come to life at beastofwar.com.
So now we have a segment called Crowdfunders, or something to that effect.
You should do like an epic voiceover for this. Crowdfunders!
Crowdfunders! See, we're starting...
There's the voice of God return.
That's it. See, what we're trying to do is we're trying to get a couple of kind of segments into the show now. So we've got the, what is happening this week in gaming? And Crowdfunders! So anyway... It's a bit about Kickstarters. People enjoy the Kickstarter stuff. We know we get to see a lot of them. Yeah. So we thought, why don't we, on the weekend, try and bring you some that we think are interesting.
That's a curse. I've seen a couple of people comment that, how do I find the cool Kickstarters?
Yeah. Well, we have some cool Kickstarters for you.
Yes, indeed we do. First up, we're going to talk about Dark Age Outpost.
Oh! Poof. Oh, what a cool one.
Popped
right,
out of
if
the blue.
You are an orc player... someone who enjoys the Dark Ages, someone who plays Frostgrave, someone who plays any of the Mantic Kings of War stuff, you play Saga, check this out. Mm-hmm. So what we have here is a hard plastic Dark Age outpost. So it's basically wooden fort, okay? Wooden forts are
that is
us.
Completely modular, which is something I love about it.
Just now, look at it now. This is very cool.
This emphasizes the modularness of it. This you can see here that we're built up with all the bits. Like there's a separate wall up in the top corner. Then there's a separate gate. Then we've separate towers. And then a separate keep. So it all ends up being a modular system. And on their Kickstarter page, there's some
a
images
nice map
of here you go.
Look at this. Look at this!
Of all sort of different layouts you can do.
The other thing is you have to check out the pledge levels on this, right? Because there are pledge levels where you're going in at, I'm paraphrasing, like somewhere around $100, and you end up with like 100 pieces of kit.
Each pledge gives you different amounts of wall sections and different amounts of towers. I'm assuming that some of these layouts are probably tied very closely to pledge levels. For example, this one's probably like
it looks like a really nice functional type of fort.
It's cool, and here's why it's cool, right? You know, you could sit and try and hobby this stuff, right? But to try and find the tree branches that you need to get in and then sharpen all the edges and stuff like that.
And then the number of times you stab and cut yourself doing that.
The other good thing about this is it's going to be so easy to paint. Okay? You get this stuff, you get an army painter brown spray.
Beastie brown.
Prime the whole thing, paint the tops with the skeleton bone or something like that, and then just give the whole thing a strong tone wash. And you are done.
I would have dry brushed a lot just to bring it back a little bit.
Yeah, you could give it a dry brush if you wanted. But as a hobby product, this is so cool. I want to see them do this with castle walls, never mind.
That would be cool.
This, so.
It is cool. And do you remember we talked about accessories and stuff? You were showing pigs off earlier in the show.
Yes.
This also has accessories and stuff that hopefully will get unlocked so you can have...
Yeah.
I think this is what you're on about here, Lloyd.
Things like...
you have the upgrade kits for wall platforms.
And the spit roast
and
the cart and things like that. And the little wall platforms allow your men to run up to the wall and actually defend your fort. Things like that are just nice additions rather than just being a set of walls.
The other thing that I want it for, right, is I want it for dungeon crawling, right? Because I've been thinking...
Everything's dungeon crawling.
I'm so dungeon crawling.
It's not that word vomit on here.
Remember, kids, I've been dungeon crawling from before most of you were born. Because it's getting cool now. I want to make sure people realize I was into it when it wasn't cool.
So you're not the hipster?
I'm going to try and get the hipster beard. But here's my thoughts on it, right? So, as you know, I'm working on a dungeon crawling series for Backstage, right? We're going to be leading... Well, I'm going to be watching a merry band of adventurers make their way through my dark dungeon.
Right.
Okay? With all sorts of beasts and horrors and stuff like that there. I'll give you a plot line that I'm thinking about.
Right.
What happens if during all these adventures, okay, that suddenly you find yourself at the head of an army and that you have to basically defeat or take one of these forts?
That could be interesting.
You see? So there's, you know, you could create a great kind of dungeon crawler environment with this stuff. Like you bring it up. Go to this one here, right? So on this particular screen, you look at the different layouts, right? Look how enclosed and stuff you could make that. You could make windy passageways and stuff like that there. Because, yeah, you could do a fort round and stuff like that. That's all very interesting. But imagine forts that are more interesting shapes and you're having to battle your way through different bosses to get to the middle of the fort where the treasure or where the princess or whatever.
So you're not talking about fantasy
trenches.
Actually, it's more like
wooden fortress.
Do you remember was it Fable where I battled the scorpion? The giant scorpion.
I vaguely remember a giant scorpion.
Yeah, it was in one of the Fable games, but before even getting to a battle with one of the big bosses, I remember I had to go through kind of like a fort encampment. And I had to battle my way through that before I even got to the big boss at the end.
Yeah.
And this is what I'm saying here, is you could do some awesome kind of encampments. It's all about thinking outside the box with terrain like this. This stuff, I think, would be fairly easy to store. It's hard plastic, so it's going to be a piece of cake to put it together. It'll hold the paint really well as well. And I think, you know, as a something that you can throw down a respectable amount of cash You know, it's, I've seen Kickstarters for castles where they needed $1,000 to deliver you deliver you anything of any particular scale.
Well, that's a good point. Go back to the main Kickstarter page. This seems to be pretty accessible.
Yeah. Yes.
They're already successfully funded, aren't they?
Yes, they're twice funded, at least.
So it's going to happen. Yeah. Like that's just at the time recording. That's probably gone up since we recorded the show.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is looking good. I like the look of it a lot. I like the fact that they've got towers and keeps and things. The only thing I'm not sure about is the miniatures. I don't understand why they've tacked on the miniatures.
Yeah,
I think there's a couple of stretch goals where you may get
But it's the same miniatures.
I don't know why you bothered, guys. You know, just focus on more of this.
The important thing as well is, you see that little symbol? The project is EU-friendly.
Yeah. Yes, well, from a shipping perspective, it's good. But what I would like to see, can we throw some ideas out? Yeah?
Yeah. Okay.
I want to see some round towers, okay? Because that's all very square. Mm. See if you can get your tooling to give you some kind of round towers. I also want to see a bridge.
But made in the wood for us, mm-hmm. it's all the same thing.
Also, is there something that could create some kind of bridge or log road or something like that?
Well, actually, you know, now to mention it, them round fortifications would be really cool, because here in the town in Coleraine we have a hill fort from like many years ago,
at least 1965 I think it was.
It's actually somewhere around the 1600s.
Is it
1665 I think it was.
I know we actually live in a part of Ireland the most that's been populated for the longest. I think it's like 7,000 years or something people have been living
here.
Well,
you know, it depends, you know, according to Graham Hancock. You know, we may... Graham Hancock? You don't know him?
No.
You know Graham.
You know Graham?
No.
You don't know Graham?
I don't know Graham.
Well, according to Graham Hancock, you know, the parts of the world have been populated by advanced civilizations for maybe 13,500 years.
Right.
So these are intelligent civilizations, Justin.
Okay.
So...
Not including me, then.
So we're into the land of bollocks now, aren't we?
Yeah, well, anyway. But, yes, we have a lot of forts, we have a lot of castles and things like that around here where we live. It has long settlements. I love this stuff. Mm-hmm. I think this is very, very cool. But forget about the miniatures, guys. Focus on more and more of the actual terrain itself.
I would agree.
I think the whole point of the miniatures was just so people would realize what the product was by able to see.
But I wonder, do they realize what the product is? Because although it's a Dark Age outpost, what it actually is an amazing orc settlement, either for space orcs or for orcs within any fantasy game.
Yeah, well, if you're going to orcify it, you'll stick a... Well, basically, you'll put glue in your hand, grab your bits, and throw them at it.
Yeah, it has the potential to be such a wonderful, wonderful piece of terrain for Age of Sigmar.
I could
do so much with this.
Don't crucify me, but you could probably use it in like Wild West games and stuff.
For
cavalry forts and things.
Yeah. Although that would, you could. There's no reason why it's a wee bit Dark Age for that. I would probably skip the keeps and stuff like that and just use the
things.
I don't know. Maybe.
Because you get the walls, you get the gate, and inside you stick in some oldie westy buildings and drop the keep, and suddenly you've got something that's good for...
So basically you just want some log cabins with little tin chimneys and stuff coming
out.
Well,
I'm telling you now, if I were an Age of Sigmar player who was still reeling at the not being able to get that big castle-y thing that was put out for Age of Sigmar, you know, the one with all the skulls and stuff all over.
Yeah, don't bring that up.
Oh, okay. Well, anyway,
trust me, we already spent I think about 20 minutes in a previous show just haranguing that.
Well, no, you don't need to harangue it.
I
dislike the price of it. I thought it set a very bad example. But this, however, this stuff here, if you're an Age of Sigmar player, you got to get over and have a look at this stuff here, because there is absolutely no reason why in one of the realms, especially one of them darker, maybe shadow realms or something like that, you know, your guys will be fighting through the likes of this.
I think it's good stuff, and the Age of Sigmar does need more terrain because it is skirmishy now.
Yes.
So if you're having boring battles,
add more terrain.
That would probably help.
Yeah, depending on how you lay it out.
Right, I have another Kickstarter that I'm mad keen to talk about.
Mm-hmm. You really like this one.
And it caught my eye.
Yeah.
It's the Icarus Project.
Yeah, yep. So this.
Bring up the screen. This, I just love the miniatures for this?
Sort of sci-fi-esque cowboy? I'm going to just pass this to Lloyd.
I will take control at this point.
Okay.
Because I was just blown away by the look of this. So that's where it is at the minute. Again, the pledge levels, ignore that. You can go check it out now because this is probably updated since we recorded it. Okay. It's got two main factions at the minute with more sort of
on the way,
connected to stretch goals and stuff here. So here you can see the Alliance starter set and the Nexus starter set.
Oh, I really like the Nexus.
I'm sorry, it's like the Alliance for me. Too.
And we'll get to that in a minute. But I have some close-ups of some of the Alliance stuff.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Yes, 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 yes.
Isn't that looking sweet? Really, really nice stuff.
And it looks very paintable, I've got to say.
It is very paintable. And this is their like their first miniature.
Yeah.
I mean, the first miniature, that's what they get.
Yeah. It's really, really nice. Really crisp details on that.
Yeah, it is well done, isn't it?
This one's called Gabriel Cross.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing that really draws me into this game,
and
we haven't even got to it yet, is the artwork. Now, normally I'm a bit of a miniatures, and the artwork kind of secondary.
Yeah.
In this, I'm just blown away by the artwork. Let me bring up some. We'll get to the Nexus because I think they're really so cool.
Right. Okay.
But we'll start with the artwork for the Alliance.
Uh-huh.
I mean, just check it out.
Yes.
I love the Alliance troops right in the middle.
Yeah. That scout is gorgeous.
You like Outrider scout?
Each to their own, but I really like the tactical look that they've got going on there. Now we'll get to the Nexus and bring up some of their artwork. Just check this stuff out.
Now, this is what I like, okay? Because I think we have been struggling to have good alien beasties.
Yes.
Right? I've been a little bit underwhelmed recently by the aliens that have been appearing in miniatures games. You know, when you look at how cool some of the aliens are and the likes of Gears of War and stuff like that there, I wasn't really getting a lot of that from a lot of the miniatures games. But these guys here, look at the arms!
I just love it when you say I've got a picture of the actual models and stuff. The 3D renders of what the models look like. Mm. Just check them out!
Yeah.
How awesome does that look? The fact that they can wield weapons and have two knives. This is the faction for me. So much so that normally I don't really jump into Kickstarters because we get a lot of stuff coming through.
Have you been a naughty boy, Lloyd?
And we don't have a lot of time.
Have you backed it?
30 quid will get me this faction and a rule book. I haven't yet backed it, but I'm like this close to going, you know what, I'm just going to jump on this one.
Just go do it.
Because
just go do it, yeah.
These guys, I mean, look at that.
Uh-huh.
They are bringing that up again.
I mean, I like this. I just happen to really, really like these aliens. I think that they're fearsome and they're, excuse the pun, but they are totally well armed.
Oh!
Ow! Are you proud of that?
Oh.
Are you proud of that?
Right, let me just read out some points, okay? So you can get the rules now for free. Mm-hmm. There's like a PDF because it's in beta. It's already been tested a lot, but if you're liking the look of it, pop on, download the PDF rulebook.
Yeah.
That's where you'll get even more art, and you'll just go, oh!
Mm-hmm.
Now, the reason the art's so good, well, one of the reasons, is they've already spent $6,000.
Yeah.
Sorry, £6,000.
Right.
Getting to where they are.
To getting artwork done and starting some of the sculpting.
Mm-hmm.
See, I like that. I like when a company, even before the company Kickstarter, are going to that level of investment.
And when you download the PDF, you're already looking at going, this looks sweet, and it's just like a prototype PDF. Let me bring up some pages now. Yeah. The Nexus, you think they look cool here. Where do you see this? What this Nexus guy's doing when we bring up the picture.
Okay.
Hell
check this out.
Oh, he's got a chopper. Oh, I love it.
I was chopper, like, shotgun, and axe.
Oh my god. He can drive the bike and shoot and wield an axe all at the same time.
Right. Now, that I wasn't expecting.
Yeah.
That I wasn't expecting. I also like the guy in the black here with the skull face.
Yeah. Mm. And the art just keeps continuing on to be class. Where do you see this next picture? Just class. A very Destiny-esque sort of look there.
That's what I was wondering. Yeah, it felt like something. Destiny is a kind of a vibe that it has. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it a lot. There's a couple of other factions. I'll bring up some more artwork, and that'll show them off. Now, in this picture, we can see, now this is really horrible. What is it? The Parasedans.
Uh-huh.
On the...
I like the guy with the grubbly, tentacly face.
Yeah. I think they're called the Jitar.
The Perseidians and the Jitar.
The Jitar.
Yeah.
And then in the PDF, you can see droids and stuff as well.
Uh-huh.
Oh,
I don't know. I like this person in the white here. The weapon just has a really fluid feel to it. Really nice.
Again, they're good aliens. Yeah. Like the Gribbly Face guy is a good. They're all humanoid.
Yes.
But they are all different enough. Yes. As well. You know, is it, this is what. A, you know, they feel like armies. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes I'm not a massive fan of these kinds of hodgepodge aliens that have all banded together to create a resistance or something like that there. I like my aliens to feel strong, to feel like armies, and they're wearing their armor, and they're going to kick some ass.
Agreed.
I think that's cool, and I really like that. And I can see armies from these guys.
Yeah.
You know, they feel like they've got the beginnings of armies, and they feel like they're suitably different enough to warrant being armies of their own.
And the styles you're seeing here actually give you sort of a feel for their cultures.
And it's really clean artwork, but in a gritty sort of sense. Mm-hmm. For example, she's lost an arm or something. I just admire that.
I haven't even noticed that, yeah.
She's got a robotic arm and things like that. I just can't wait to see more of this game. And miniatures-wise, if I bring up, here's the sort of scales that we're looking at. Okay, so they're a 35mm model.
Yeah.
Okay. Stands just higher than a 28mm heroic figure, so let me bring that up. Here you can see the way the Alien Nexus faction.
Yeah.
The guy's a lot, well, he's about 6 inches taller, not in real life, but on this picture, than the human faction.
Yeah.
They've said that, you know, the alien, not all the miniatures are going to end up the same size.
Yeah.
Depending on the race you pick, they will have different heights and stuff to them. And I like that. Because sometimes you can have a range where all the miniatures just seem to be exactly the same size.
They're all hitting that flat 28mm.
Regardless of what faction they are, and I just find that a little bit
that looks good to me.
A little bit boring at times. This effectively makes them 48 scale.
Yeah,
that's what they are, and they're going to be resin. Going to be resin miniatures.
Yeah,
that's cool. Normally I don't really dig the resin miniature stuff, but let me just bring this back.
Sorry, we'll get you an HBT suit.
So let me just bring this up again and have a look at that. That's just I think I might just have to back that.
Yeah, so you're going to go in for the rulebook and the grunts, the Nexus grunts.
Yeah, in the Nexus starter set, you get one Nexus assault with sniper rifle, two Nexus grunts, two feral Nexus, one Nexus brawler.
Yeah.
In the Alliance, I'll bring up the picture. In the Alliance, you get one gunslinger, one female outrider, one male trooper with LMG, two male troopers with assault rifles, and one female trooper with assault rifle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Class looking stuff.
Beautiful.
Can't wait to see more of that.
Mm-hmm. Well, have we time to fit one more Kickstarter in before we go?
It's not in the running order. Have we another one to talk about?
I have one more.
This is just the episode where you're crowbarring stuff in, isn't it?
Yes. There is a little startup company called Red Dragon. And they're going to Kickstarter with this.
Ooh, hello.
Okay. So it's pre-painted.
Let's see, I think I have a camera you can put that on.
Pre-flocked. Can we have a closer one? Pre-painted, pre-flocked trench systems, okay? So let me just get a... They're a little UK company. I had a letter from them, because I love getting letters. So basically, they have a Kickstarter launching now. It's ending on the 11th of October, and this stuff here is available. There's lots of different types of it, and it's available either as raw resin or pre-finished, okay? So this is the...
So what's this? This 28mm stuff, is it?
Yep, it worked perfectly. I was testing it because, as well as this, I'd actually opened a couple as well of some other ones.
Right.
So
if we start making it sort of a...
Yeah, start putting together a trench.
Trench layout.
So
I see you have some other bits down here. I'll just give you a hand and, and bring them up.
So...
Well, that's not a trench. You're making a fort.
Well, I'm making a fort, yeah. So...
Let me hit.
There we go.
There you go. Bit more trenchy looking. Swing that, say, that way or something.
Okay, and then you have them.
They'll be watching the show saying, you're crucifying our trenches.
You're crucifying our trench. But, so this is it here. I've been playing with it. It works perfectly for 28mm. It also is really good for the 15mm stuff as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It all comes, this is exactly as it comes finished if you opt for the pre-finished stuff.
Yeah, let me just bring that up closer.
The actual finished quality of it is... actually really nice. The only suggestion I can make to the guys on the Kickstarter is be careful of the packaging, because some little bits, like here, like there...
They'll take a little knock?
Well, what you find is that they actually get knocked off, and then you have to sit and glue them together. So, packaging-wise, needs a little bit of attention, but the end product, I think, looks grand. I really like it. And you can, like I said, you can either get it finished like this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or you can get it in the raw resin, where it's a bit cheaper.
Oh, raw resin and get it cheaper, that's cool.
Yeah, and then paint it up to suit whatever you want. But when it comes to earthworks like this,
yeah,
I'm tempted to always just go with the finished stuff, because mud is mud.
Mud is mud!
Yeah, mud is mud. Most of us will probably be putting that down on top. The only thing it maybe you would want to change is the hue of the actual static grass on it, but you know, that static grass is fairly generic. You know, it'll work across most gaming mats.
If your grass mat's darker than that, you could probably wash it or something, and that would
add some extra static grass to the thing.
Yeah,
you know, it, like I said, you can get it unfinished if you so desire. Mm. But as a little trench set goes,
I'm just ranging them so everyone can see them from the other view.
As a little trench set goes, I really, really like it. I think it's great.
Very cool.
Nice, quick, easy to store. So if you have any World War One games or anything like that coming up, check out Red Dragon Gaming and have a look at their... You can go to reddragongaming.co.uk and they should be on Kickstarter at the moment.
Excellent. So. Now, just before we move off the Kickstarters, I'll just recap. If you like the Dark Age post, basically, just search for Dark Age Post on the Kickstarter. Dark Age Outpost.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If you like the Icarus Project, just search for Icarus Project. And that one was what again?
Red Dragon Gaming. And you can go to reddragongaming.co.uk or just do a search for Red Dragon Gaming on Kickstarter. Cool. You going to announce some winners?
Well, Dawn's going to announce a winner.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Because we have a wee clip for Dawn, because remember we were doing the prize for the Jezebel?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So Dawn has picked her winner and she has a wee message for us. I think we'll just watch that now.
Right, take it away, Dawn.
Hey everybody, guess what time it is? It is prize time! This is probably going to be my favorite video ever because I get to give something away! So first of all, let me thank all of you that took time to come over and comment on the Jezebel article. It was so much fun and I enjoyed reading every single comment. Loved some of the insight people gave for the way you would use Jezebel, things that maybe I could have done differently with her. There were a couple of really good suggestions that, in hindsight, I kind of wish I would have thought of, but see, that's the joy of creating something. We'll file them away for a later date. One of the things that I really, really enjoyed was a few of you commented on a little bit of insight to what you thought Jezebel was all about, kind of maybe where she came from, who she is, and it just makes me that much more excited to share my story that I've written for her. But you have to wait at least a little while longer, and that'll come out in the next piece. So, one of you lucky people are going to be the winner of your very own copy of Jezebel. I just finished a deal, and I will be working with Prodos to produce the Jezebel miniature. She will be resin. You will receive a copy of your very own Jezebel, as well as a piece of artwork for her, which will be really, really great. So, this one lucky winner is going to be Manpug. So, congratulations to you, Manpug. Make sure you take time and come over to claim your prize on the link and let the guys know your information. And as soon as I have Jezebel in my possession, I will make sure we pass a copy of her over to you. So follow along, look for the next piece of the article. Whenever I get her, I will do another piece on the creation of her being brought into being made into a miniature, as well as her background story. So. Thanks so much for following along with us, and again, congrats to you, Manpug.
Manpug again?
Yeah.
Lucky sod.
Congratulations, Manpug. That is a nice prize. Yeah. I happen to think that what Dawn and the crew that she's been working with on that miniature has been beautiful.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Well, she's getting them done by Prodos, because she's in the video there. You could hear her saying Prodos is going to make the miniatures for her.
So they should look really good.
They should look nice. They're very good at the resin.
All right, we have one more winner to announce, if I may.
This is the Paranormal Exterminator.
Yeah, our winner is from YouTube, and it's Haley B.
Well done.
So we have a female winner for once.
Well done.
Possibly.
Yeah, possibly. But Haley, go over to come on over to beastofwar.com and up here, up there. There's a contact us where there's a claim a prize button. So that come goes, across and claim your prize.
That goes for you as well, Manpug. Use the form, claim your prizes. Mm. Right, guys. I think that pretty much wraps up the show. If you've enjoyed it, come on across to Beast of War, join backstage. You'll get to watch another show just like this tomorrow, and we have a whole range of other things in backstage. Other shows like painting tutorials, crafting tutorials, gameplay videos. It's jam-packed.
Yeah. All the plogs, which are the project logs, where there's armies and terrain and all sorts of stuff that we're working on that you can follow along and see little mini tutorials and how different aspects and all of it are done. There's tons, but mostly you just want to join because it's great crack watching him squirm at the prospect of what monsters he's going to face at the moment. Yeah. It is brilliant.
Right, guys. Hopefully we'll see you then. And until then, have a great weekend of gaming.
See you soon, guys.
Become a general of mighty armies at the Kings of War Hub. Take command of elves, dwarves, and orcs in this game of masked fantasy combat on beastsofwar.com. Flames of War brings you the battles of World War II in epic 15mm scale. Go to the hub on beastsofwar.com to find news, tactics, and tutorials about the game.